Hey everyone, it's Justin again. Welcome back to another lesson on quadratics. In this lesson, we'll be building on our quadratics knowledge with the introduction of the one and only quadratic formula. There are two warm-up problems on the cover page of your PDF. If you haven't had a chance to work on those yet, pause the video to do that now. So, what did you think about those warm-up problems? Did you run into any issues? You may have found that you were able to factor this first equation, and your work may have looked something like this, but what about that second equation? Were you able to factor that one? You may have found yourself thinking, hey, I can't factor this. What's going on? And you would have been correct because we can't use factoring to solve this problem. So does that mean it's unsolvable? Well, like a lot of things in life, just because one method of solving doesn't work, it doesn't mean it's unsolvable. And we're in luck because there actually is a method that we can use to solve quadratic equations that will work every single time, the quadratic formula. This is the quadratic formula. X equals negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac all over 2a. The quadratic formula is, arguably, the most helpful formula in all of algebra. You see, way back in the 7th century, mathematicians began to realize that quadratics all follow similar patterns, and eventually they were able to use those patterns to create the quadratic formula. A formula capable of solving any quadratic equation, even those that aren't able to be factored. So, what are we waiting for? Let's test it out with some example problems. We have the quadratic equation 2x squared minus 9x plus 7 equals 0. And we want to solve for x. All we have to do is substitute numbers in for the variables in the formula and solve. But what numbers should we use for A, B, and C? Well, the standard form of a quadratic equation is AX squared plus BX plus C equals 0. A is the coefficient of the X squared term, B is the coefficient of the X term, and C is the constant. Using this knowledge, can you identify what values we should use for A, B, and C from our original equation? The coefficient of the x squared term is 2, so that'll be our a value. Next up is the x term, which is minus 9x, meaning negative 9 is the coefficient of the x term. So negative 9 is our b value. Our last term, plus 7, is the constant, so the c value is positive 7. Are we ready to use the quadratic formula now? Yes, we are. So, do you remember when you first learned about substitution? You learned that it's best to use parentheses when substituting something into another expression, like this. And using parentheses will be extremely important whenever you use the quadratic formula. It helps to keep things organized and avoid any potential mistakes. So, pause here to substitute the A, B, and C values into the quadratic formula in your guided notes. The first variable in this formula is b, and it has a negative sign in front of it. Here's a prime example of why it's important to use those parentheses whenever you're substituting. The b value we got from our original equation is negative 9, and this part of the formula says negative b. The first negative is built into the formula itself, and the second negative is part of what we're substituting in for the b variable. So what this actually means is negative negative 9. And as we know, a negative times a negative is a positive. So this negative negative 9 will eventually simplify to regular old positive 9, but we'll keep it as is for now. Moving on, this chunk inside the square root becomes negative 9 inside parentheses squared minus 4 times 2 times 7. Here's another reason why using parentheses when substituting is important. Negative 9 squared and negative 9 in parentheses squared are two totally different things and will result in two different answers. So we need to show that we are squaring the whole negative 9. Finally, all of this is over 2a, which becomes 2 times 2. Now we simplify following the order of operations. GEMS tells us to start with groupings. Are there any groupings here? Since this equation has a fraction bar in the middle, both the numerator and denominator are their own groupings, and they each need to be simplified before we can move on from this first step of GEMS. You could start with whichever you prefer, but since the denominator looks a lot less complicated, I'm going to start there. In the denominator, we have 2 times 2, which simplifies to 4. Now that the denominator grouping is totally taken care of, we could focus our attention on the numerator grouping. When simplifying inside a grouping, like the numerator of this equation, we restart GEMS and then follow the order of operations all the way through until everything within that grouping is simplified. So, are there any groupings within the numerator grouping? In this case, since there's more than one term under the radical symbol, this whole chunk is considered a group. So pause here to simplify the section under the radical in your guided notes. Negative 9 squared is 81. Then we have negative 4 times 2, which is negative 8. And negative 8 times 7 is negative 56. Then 81 minus 56 is 25. That takes care of the groupings within the numerator grouping. And keep in mind, if you need some time to think, add to your notes, or you just want to see something again, you can always pause or rewind the video at any point. Up next in GEMS is exponents. There aren't any exponents in the numerator grouping, but there is something that falls under the E step. Any ideas what that might be? Because the square root symbol represents the opposite of squaring, radicals fall in the E step of GEMS along with exponents. And luckily, 25 is a perfect square, so we can totally simplify it. What number multiplied by itself equals 25? 5. Any others? Yeah, also negative 5. But how do we write the positive and negative results in the middle of an equation? Well, that's why the formula already has this plus or minus symbol built in. Square roots have both positive and negative answers, so the formula is already written in a way to help us keep track of both the positive and negative square root results. Now that we've completed the E step of GEMS, we're moving on to M, multiplication and division. We know that a negative times a negative is positive, giving us positive 9, and that takes care of the M step within this numerator grouping and brings us to the S, subtraction and addition. How do you think we should proceed from here? We can't both add and subtract 5 at the same time. It appears we've reached a roadblock in simplifying this numerator grouping. So what should we do? Well, since we can't add and subtract at the same time, let's split them up and simplify each numerator grouping separately. That gives us two separate equations. X equals 9 plus 5 over 4, and X equals 9 minus 5 over 4. Go ahead and finish solving for both solutions in your guided notes. We'll check your work when you're done. For this first equation, 9 plus 5 is 14, and then we can simplify this fraction to 7 over 2. For the second equation, 9 minus 5 is 4, and 4 over 4 simplifies to 1. So there we have it. The solutions to our original equation are 7 over 2 and 1. Did you notice that this was problem number 1 on the PDF warm-up found on the cover sheet? If factored correctly, you should have gotten the same answers through factoring as we did by using the formula. Pretty cool, huh? Let's try another one. X squared plus 6x equals 2. Before we can use the formula, there is a minor problem we need to address. Can you spot what it is? Before we can use the formula, our equation needs to be in standard form. Ax squared plus bx plus c equals zero. So how can we fix it? If we subtract 2 from both sides, now our equation is equal to 0 and in standard form. Hey, this is the second equation from the PDF warm-up. That one was unfactorable. So now we have the opportunity to put the quadratic formula to the test. Can it really give us solutions to quadratic equations that aren't able to be factored? Time to find out. From this equation, what are our a, b, and c values? A, the coefficient of the x squared term is 1, b is 6, and c is negative 2. Why don't you give this one a try by yourself? Substitute the values into the formula, and following GEMS, simplify the equation as much as you can. If you ever get stuck, just join back in and we'll finish solving it together. After substituting in those values, your equation should look like this. Starting with the denominator grouping, 2 times 1 simplifies to 2, and now we're ready to tackle the numerator grouping. Within the numerator, we have a subgrouping under the radical symbol. 6 squared is 36, then negative 4 times 1 is negative 4, and negative 4 times negative 2 is positive 8. 36 plus 8 gives us 44. This might be, understandably, where you got stuck while working by yourself. 44 is not a perfect square, so where do we go from here? It's been a while since we've worked with radicals. Can you remember any strategies for working with radicands that aren't perfect squares? We could just type it into our calculators, but that's going to give us a number with a never-ending decimal, which would mean we would have to round. So what should we do if you want our answer to be as precise as possible? Since we want to be precise, that rules out rounding and estimating, which leaves us with simplifying. The square root of 44 can be rewritten as the square root of 4 times the square root of 11, which simplifies to plus or minus 2 times the square root of 11. From here, we can get rid of these parentheses around the 6, giving us negative 6. As now we've reached the last step of simplifying the numerator, subtraction and addition. Remember, that plus or minus symbol means we actually have two different equations here. X equals both negative 6 plus 2 times the square root of 11 over 2, and negative 6 minus 2 times the square root of 11 over 2. Both numerators of our now two equations are simplified as much as possible. So what should we focus on next? Let's refer back to GEMS. Both the numerator and denominator groupings and the square roots are simplified as much as possible, so that takes care of the G and E steps. The M stands for multiplication and division, and we do have some division here. Each of these numerators have two terms, so due to the distributive property of division, we can rewrite the equations so that each term in the numerator is divided by the denominator. Starting with the equation on the left, negative 6 divided by 2 is negative 3, and 2 divided by 2 is 1, leaving us with the square root of 11. We could do the same thing with the equation on the right, leaving us with our final answers. Negative 3 plus the square root of 11, and negative 3 minus the square root of 11. Although the factoring method of solving quadratic equations can sometimes be more efficient, the quadratic formula is an important tool to have in our toolbox because it allows us to find the solutions every time, even if the equation is unfactorable. When using the quadratic formula, there are a few things we need to keep in mind. First, the equation must be in standard form, so always check that your equation is organized from highest degree to lowest and that it's equal to zero. Next, when substituting in your A, B, and C values, always use parentheses around any substituted values to help you keep track of your positive and negative values. Finally, if, while solving, you find yourself with a non-perfect square under the radical. Just simplify the square root as much as possible. Once you've finished up your guide and notes, check out the additional practice in your PDF. And after that, all that's left is the online practice. Keep practicing those quadratics, and I'll see you next time. Hey.